أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. صدق الله العظيم.
نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألم نشرح لك صدرك ووضعنا عنك وزرك الذي أنقض ظهرك ورفعنا لك ذكرك. فإن مع العسر يسرا، إن مع العسر يسرا، فإذا فرغت فانصب وإلى ربك فارغب. صدق الله العظيم. First thing that should be noted is that according to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala an, this Surah Al-Duha and Surah Al-Inshirah are one surah. They are not two surahs. He used to recite both these surahs in one rak'ah of the prayer without in between reciting Ayah Bismillah. But they are two surahs. There is no doubt. Consensus of all the other companions of the Prophet ﷺ is that they are different surahs. And I suppose that to make them a pair, so that you know that thing is fulfilled, that the surahs of Quran are mostly in pairs, so it has been divided. Otherwise, the style is the same. Alam yajidka yateeman fa'awa, wa wajadaka dhalan fahada, wa wajadaka ayl, alam nashrah laka sadrak, wa wada'na anka wizrak. الَّذِي أَنْقَدَ ظَهْرَكَ. The same style, the same, you know, conversation, you may say, or communication between Allah and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at a very, very, very personal level, secretly. And what I said before about Surah Al-Duha, it's more important regarding Surah Al-Inshirah, that this surah could not be understood except by those mufassireen. They are the interpreters and exegetes, but they have a mystic orientation, spiritual and mystic. Because Alam Nashrah Laka Sadrak, have we not expanded or opened up for you your chest? Wada'na anka wizrak, and we have removed from you that heavy burden. Allazi anqadha dharak, which was nearly breaking your back. وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ, and we have exalted for you your renown and fame. فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا, إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. So always, along with hardship is ease. And again, surely, along with hardship is ease. فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ فَانْصَبْ. So when you have accomplished your task, the mission assigned to you, fansab, then exert yourself fully. وَإِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَارْغَبْ, and let your towards your Lord be your entire quest. Now this is known, that this is from among the very early Makki surahs. And the conditions for the Prophet and the companions of the Prophet were very hard. They had to struggle hard at that time. Where was the ease? Had this surah been revealed in Medina, it would have meant something else. Those hard times are gone. Now, the things are very easy for you, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No. Very early Makkah surahs. So what does it mean? What was ease to him? What was the meaning of the expanding of his chest? What was the meaning that he was relieved of the burden that was nearly going to break his back? Now let me quote here But I am giving you, and I agree with, that is from Qazi Sanaullah Panipati Rahmatullahi Alayh, one of the mystic Mufassirin of Indian subcontinent of the last century. He says, actually, for a prophet or a saint, the most lovable thing is that he should keep solely, exclusively attentive to his Lord. Why to discharge the duties as a messenger? You have to go out. You have to talk to the people. You want to keep yourself engaged in meditation with your Lord. Go on in your lonely place, praying to Him, talking to Him, conversing with Him. Let your soul have a direct communication with your Lord. This is the most enjoyable thing that a human being can ever imagine. But now, the command is go. Izhab ila Fir'aun innahu tagha. Go to Fir'aun. He has transgressed. Now you have to face. But the biggest pain that he is having is that that condition which he had when he was talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Mount of Tur, how pleasant it was. So Allama Iqbal has quoted Shaykh Abdul Qaddus of Gango in his lectures. Once he said, Muhammad Arabi Balai Asma Raft to Baz Ahmad. بخدا اگر من رفتمے باز نہ آمدمے. Muhammad of Arabia went to the highest heaven and then came back. By God, if I had reached there, I would never have come back. So this is the difference between the mystic experience and the prophetic experience. A mystic, a Sufi, wants to keep himself with his Lord. No interference. This is the tendency which led to that monasticism. This was an unbalanced attitude that led to monasticism. Why to marry? Have all these, you know, problems. 100,001 problems for you if you marry. You have a family, now you have to feed them, care for them. Now the child is sick, and now you have to get him admitted to the school, and so on and so forth. Now you can't have that, you know, that sukoon, tranquility of your mind. Baithe rahe tasavvur jana kiye hue. Keep sitting and have the thought of Allah in your mind and nothing else. So that was the pain actually which Muhammad was having sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while he was asked to go out, preach to the people. We are looking only to the outside pain that he was getting when some said, oh, you have gone crazy, oh, you are a poet, oh, you are a sorcerer or a magician. This was also hurting him. But that is not mentioned here. That, you know, his difficulties were going to more and more multiply in the coming years. But alam nashrah laka sadrak. That was painful to him was his occupation with this propagation of religion and not keeping himself alone in the loneliness. Plotinus has said very beautiful verse, flight of the alone to the alone. Within us we have something which is alone, and that is our ruh. Ruh is not son of someone and daughter of someone and brother of someone. No, ruh has no connection with anybody here in this world. It's all alone. Whatever it is by itself. So when one is sitting and contemplating and meditating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the flight of the alone. The ruh within me and you now comes out, goes up, 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 up. Flight of the alone to the alone. Qul huwa Allahu ahad. He is the alone. Alam nashrah laka sadrak wa wada'na anka wizrak alladhi anqadha dhahrak wa rafa'na laka dhikrak. As time progressed, Muhammad came to know how much it is delightful for you when even a single person accepts Islam and you feel, now this brother of mine is saved from the fire of hell. This is another delight. This delight now takes the place of that delight. The Sufia used three terms for suluk. There is sair ilallah, one is going nearer, nearer, nearer to Allah. Then sair fillah, now contemplating and meditating the person or the attributes of Allah. This is that position from which if you are asked to go away, then you feel pain, you feel hurt. But the third stage is sair anillah ilallah. Now you are going away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to go down the Mount of Noor, where Muhammad received his first revelation in the cave of Hira, Jabal al-Noor. And Musa had to come down from Koh-e-Tur, the Mount of Tur. Izhab ila Fir'auna innahu tagha. But that sair anillah ilallah. But this is for Allah. So that more and more of his creatures, they are saved from the fire of hell. They turn towards Allah. This is the biggest delight, biggest delight, biggest delight. But you come to it, to realize it, but you have to take some time for that. فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. This yusra has now come to you, but you had to pass that through that usr, that difficulty. You had to cross that, but now you feel. The Prophet said to Ali, Ya Ali, لَنْ يَهْدِيَ اللَّهُ بِكَ رَجُلًا وَاحِدًا خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ حُمْرِ النَّعْمِ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes even a single human being towards the right path because of you, it is much more precious than so many red camels. That was the biggest, you know, wealth for the Arabs. رَجُلًا وَاحِدًا. Guidance will be given by Allah, but you have become instrumental in it. أَنْ يَهْدِيَ اللَّهُ بِكَ. If Allah guides even one human being through you, through your effort, through your da'wah, خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ حُمْرِ النَّعَمُ. Red-colored camels, a host of them, this is more precious than that. Now, فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ. This is for the future. When that time comes, يَا الْحَقُّ وَزَحَقَ الْبَاطِلِ. When that time comes, then you'll be free. Then you attach yourself with us absolutely. فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ فَانْصَبْ وَإِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَارْغَبْ. And this is, you know, historically speaking, in the seerah, the sermon that Muhammad gave sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one evening before he died. Came out from his hujra, and you know the salah prayer was in progress. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was leading the prayer. When he felt that the Prophet has come out, he tried to get back so that he comes forward to lead the prayer, but he said, no, you continue. Then he sat by his side. Now, sitting in that sitting posture, he was the Imam of Abu Bakr, and Abu Bakr was the Imam for the rest of the congregation. That way that prayer was completed. Then he gave the sermon. Allah has given an option to a servant of his. If he likes this world, he can choose it. If he likes the other, he can choose it. And the servant has chosen the other one. Abu Bakr wept. And some of the people said, look to this old man. Why is he weeping? But Abu Bakr has understood that the Prophet has decided to go now. Because to every messenger, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives this option. Now from our side, you are free. You have done your duty. If you want to come back, okay. If you want to still stay in the world, okay. We shall grant you further lease. And that is why the last words on the tongue of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the time of death, Allahumma fir rafiq al-a'la. Now I choose rafiq al-a'la, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I give up this world. Surah At-Teen. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والتين والزيتون وطور سينين وهذا البلد الأمين لقد خلقنا الإنسان في أحسن تقويم ثم رددناه أسفل سافلين صدق الله العظيم. This surah is also philosophically and psychologically very important surah of the Quran. A sensible and sensitive person who has that moral law within him active, when he sees to the world before him, he's grieved. All human beings lying very low, nobody having any high ambition of Allah and Akhirah, everybody running after this world, the pleasures of this temporary world and temporary life, and then all types of mischief, cheating, lying, defrauding. What is this? Does man have nothing in him except evil? Perhaps man is evil through and through. Nothing high in him. And to this testify all the schools of thought of psychology of today. What are the motives? All are very low, very mean. According to Freud, it's the sex, nothing else. Even the love between mother and our son is sex. Father and daughter is sex. It's all suppressed sex that takes these forms. Somebody is giving a sermon. It is a suppressed sexual desire that he is, you know, fulfilling in this way. Someone is saying the only motive in man is to get domination, urge to dominate. And Marx said, the basic is his financial need. Anyone who says that a man has some high thing in him, none. On the other hand, Darwinian theory says man is only an animal, slightly refined animal. All these things, you know, have come together to disappoint man from man. There's nothing good in man. In this background, this surah comes up in front. No, no, no. Man was created at a very high level, very high level, very high level. Quran says, we ordered all our angels to bow before him. Khalaqtuhum biyadayya, I created this man with my both of my hands. But all this, you know, whatever you see, yes, the complexes, this inferiority complex and superiority complex, this haughtiness, and what is man? Even if apparently he is doing something, actually, the motive behind it to show off, to dominate, to be more prominent. He's delivering a very good speech, but what for? To be more prominent among the people, so that people should praise him. Oh, he's a very good speaker. Maybe out of this faculty of good speaking, public speaking, he can become a dictator. These are the motives. No high motives visible in this society, number one, or taught in psychology. But Allah says no. Now Allah is presenting four examples. Example of Nuh alayhi salam. Wateen, by the fig. Fig tree, as well as the Mount Fig, where, you know, this nation of Nuh was inhabited. There were a lot of fig trees, and that mount was called Mount of Fig. Was that one? An olive. And the Mount of Olive. Mount of Olive is still here. Who is that one? Where Isa alayhi salam used to preach. But to the Sinin, and look to this Mount of Sina, where Moses was in conversation with his Lord. Fahadal Baladil Amin, and before you is this peaceful city of Mecca. You find Muhammad in it. If there was nothing high in human beings, where from have they come up? Are they not the human beings? Was Nuh a mean or base person? Was Isa a mean or base person? Was Musa a mean or base person? Is Muhammad before you, your own eyes, is he a mean or base person? No. So you must admit that these are the oaths. But on what these oaths have been taken? لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. Verily we created man in the best nature and best mold. Ahsan is the superlative degree. The best. But this denotes to the real man, not the visible man. The visible man is this body. The real man is within it. Man in his ignorance identifies himself with the material sheets which encompass his real self. Really, when I say I denote to myself. وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَانْسَاهُمْ أَنفُسَهُمْ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. That was created at the highest level, higher than the angels. And the highest was the spirit of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But then, ثُمَّ رَدَرْنَاهُ أَسْفَلَ سَافِلِينَ. But then we threw it down, lowest than the low, lower than the lowest, lowest than the low, of the low. This regards this our animal existence. It's at a lesser level than the angels. Then at a about lesser level than the jinns. They were created out of fire, they were created out of clay. And that is why Iblis said, أَنَا خَيْرُ مِنْهُ خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ تِينٍ. How can I bow before him? Now this is the combination, the two extremes. The highest coming from there and the lowest coming from this clay, joined together. This is man. So now, what's the makhraj? What's the way out? إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Now he has to climb from this low level to reach to his original stature, original station, original level. He has to work hard. And that is through Iman and Amal Saleh. He has to ascend. Ascend higher and higher up. And two things. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. They are not the lowest of the low. No, 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 no. They will be highest of the high in the hereafter. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ فَلَهُمْ أَجْرٌ غَيْرُ مَمْنُونَ. For them there is going to be a reward which will never come to an end. Unending reward. فَمَا يُكَذِّبُكَ بَعْدُ بِالدِّينِ. Well, what after this makes you, O man, belie the recompense? There must be recompense. Whosoever is doing this, he is going higher and higher through his Iman and Amal Saleh and Jihad. This is a Jihad to ascend. You have been thrown very low. If somehow you fall into a ditch, you slip from some mountain, you are there in the ditch, Then you try. Come, come up. You don't keep lying over there. If you are dead, that's a different story. But if you are still alive, you climb. So here, we were thrown down from that high level. We have to climb up. And this climbing is this amal salih, tawasib bil haq, tawasib bil sabr, this jihad fi sabilillah. This is actually by which you can regain your original position. So then, whosoever does it, he must be recompensed. Alaysallahu bi ahkam al hakimin. Is not Allah the greatest ruler of all the rulers, or the best judge of all the judges? Bala. We should say answer, yes, why not? And I add here, Bala, inna Allah huwa ahkamul hakimin, wa huwa arhamul rahimin. What we want is mercy. Maybe according to the strict judgment, we might not be able to claim salvation. So not only hukum of Allah, but the mercy of Allah. وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. I suddenly add this. فَلَا إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَرْحَمُ الْحَاكِمِينَ وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. I have to take refuge in His mercy. Suratul Alaq, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. Now this is the first ever wahi that came to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was 40 years old, and you know, for some time his tendency was to keep alone and thinking and thinking and thinking, to be alone in the cave of Hira. And one night, when he was alone there, and please note the words, Banan Nawm wal Yaqza. He was in between sleeping and awakeness. Not fully awake, not fully asleep. The first meeting with Jibrail was in that condition, Banan Nawm wal Yaqza. So Jibrail came, and they say there is one tradition. There was a golden plate on this was written these five ayat. He said, read. He said, I am not a reader. Ma'ana biqari. Because if it was from mouth to mouth only, then this answer is not rational. If you have not learned to read, somebody says, say this, you can say this. So that to me appears to be the correct position. It was a written tablet of gold. On that these five ayat were written. Then when he said, I am not a reader, ma'ana biqari. So he took the Prophet into his arms, embraced him, and squeezed him. So much so that he felt, you know, this effect of squeezing. Then he let him, then again said, read. Again, the answer was the same. So he repeated it thrice, embracing him, squeezing him, and then letting him. And then, you know, he read these. So this is the first wahi. And because it was the first experience, a human into direct contact with an angel. This alam-e-bashariya and alam-e-malakiya. First time into direct contact. It had so deep effect on him. He was shivering like anything when he came back to his house. High fever, perspiring. And he said to Hazrat Khadija, Zammeluni, Zammeluni, Khashito ala nafsi. I fear for my life. Now give over me some blanket. Anyhow, this is the first wahi. Iqra, and now here you note, no salah, nothing of this form. Read, read. Ilm, the importance of knowledge. The knowledge that came to Muhammad was not through the worldly means of education. Allamahu shadidul quwa. Jibrail was the teacher. He taught him. In some traditions, Israfil. remained with him for 3 years, teaching him. Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Read in the name of your Lord who created. خلق الانسان من علق. Created man from a blood clot. I've read this from this translation, but I don't agree with this translation now. This clot and blood clot has no connection with this root ayn lam kaf. علق معلقة معلق ہو جانا. Something hanging. So it has denotes to that stage of embryonic development when it is like a leech attached to the wall of the womb of the mother, hanging. Hanging with the, just as a leech attaches itself to your feet or your legs in the same way. So that was the stage, alaqa. Iqra wa rabbuka al-akram, read, and your Lord is most bountiful. Alladhi allama bil qalam, who has taught by the pen. What does it mean? The human knowledge, the acquired human knowledge, has been transmitted from one generation to the other through pen. One generation gathers the knowledge, puts it down to writing, it is transferred to the next generation. This way, this acquired human knowledge, this scientific knowledge, this is going up every day. Allama al-insana ma lam ya'lam. He taught man what he knew not. After these five ayat, now three ayat, which I think I have already explained. A person whose own moral, you know, consciousness is very active and living and vibrating, and when he sees to the people, what they are doing, where are they going, what has happened to them? A thinker, a philosopher. In response to what? Surah At-Teen came. Yes, your observation is correct. They have gone down, very much down, down, down. But they were not created at that level. لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ التَّقْوِيمِ ثُمَّ رَضَرْنَاهُ أَسْفَلَ سَافِلِينَ. Here also, كَلَّا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى. Nay, man surely transgresses the limits. You are doing something wrong to your brother. Treating wrongly your neighbor, not respecting and serving your parents. You are stealing, you are killing, you are making a nation slave to you. The colonial rule, verily, the man does transgress. Your observation is not wrong. What you have seen is correct. But what is the reason? أَرَّاهُ اسْتَغْنَى. Because man feels and sees himself, he is not questioned, he is not punished, he is not rewarded. I did this thing wrong to him, nothing happened to me. I ate the wealth of the orphan, no cancer to my stomach, not even a blister to my mouth. Nothing has happened. This world is incomplete regarding the moral law. It is complete regarding the physical law. If you take poison, you will die. This is the physical law. If you put your head in the fire, it will be burnt. This is physical law. But when you tell a lie, no blister on your tongue. If you have usurped the wealth of others, nothing will come to you. So this world where these things are not rewarded, the servants of humanity not rewarded, mostly they were tortured. What happened to the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Were they honored? No. So morally speaking, this world is incomplete. It will be complete only in the hereafter, when the moral results will come fully and become manifest. كَلَّا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيْطْغَى رَاهُ اسْتَغْنَى إِنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الرُّجْعَى. Verily, to your Lord is the return. On returning, every human soul will be recompensed fully. And secondly, this is the guidance. If you want to make this society of yours healthy and good and just, tell people that they have to return to their Lord and face the grand accountability of the Day of Judgment. This is the only remedy. No justice can be established here. No fair deal will ever come here. No just order can ever be established here unless people come to know and believe, and they have conviction that they will be resurrected and they will have to stand before their Lord on the Day of Judgment. And then they will have to bear the consequences of what they are doing today. Inna ila rabbika ruj'a. This is the only remedy. Now in the rest of the ayat of this surah, in the background is the person of Abu Jahl. I told you Abu Jahl was, in a way, not very bad man. Not from amongst the worst people of Mecca. He had some good qualities. When he was asked, do you think that Muhammad is telling lies? He said, no, no, no. He never told a lie. Then why don't you accept him? No, there was a competition between us and the Banu Hashim. They entertained people in feasts. They fed the poor people. We did more than them. So the competition was going on this thing. Up till now, we are going shoulder to shoulder with them. They have not been able to outdo us. But now if we accept Muhammad as messenger of Allah, we shall have to accept slavery for all time to come. And this I am not ready to accept. So give the devil his due. He said it plainly. And he was not a miser, as I told you. Amma man bakhila, that was not in him. But Istaghna and Kazaba bil Husna, both were there. But had he accepted Islam, what would he have become? Can you imagine? He would have been the second Umar, radiallahu anhu. The traits of the character of Umar and Abu Jahl were the same. Same courageousness, same steadfastness. All these things were there, common. And that is why the Prophet had presented before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala these two persons. Allahumma ansurul Islam. O my Lord, help Islam, strengthen Islam. By the Islam of one of these two people at least. Either Umar ibn al-Khattab or Amr ibn Hisham. It was the name of Abu Jahl. Equal. Character states the same. But Allah selected Umar. That's why. But it was his lot. And he was rejected. Araayat al-lazi yanha. Have you considered the person who is forbidding Abdan Iza Sallah, the servant of ours when he is praying? There are two incidents, you know, quoted that when Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was praying in the courtyard of Kaaba. So once Abu Jahl came and he took a piece of cloth, made a rope out of it, and then strangled it round the neck, and you know, then pulled the two ends so that his eyes were coming out. And second time when he was prostrating, he said to those people who were sitting beside him, can anybody go and bring that, you know, the intestines, etc., and stomach of the camel which has been sacrificed over there. And then when Muhammad goes in sajda, in prostration, put it on his neck and head. Twice he did it. Araayta allazi yanha abdan iza salla. Araayta in kana dal huda. Can you imagine if he had been on the guidance? Aw amara bit taqwa. Or he would have been enjoining other peoples to have fear of God, how good it would have been. But he has adopted the other career. Araayta in kazzaba wa tawalla. Have you considered? If he has belied and turned his back, Alam ya'lam bi anna Allah yara, doesn't he know that Allah is seeing him? And note it, he always called upon Allah, never La tuzza, etc., etc. On the night before Badr, he called upon Allah, Allahumma aqta'una lirraham fa'ilul ghadat. Whosoever has cut our relations, divided our tribe, you humiliate him tomorrow. Allahumma. Not Hubal, not Uzza, not Lat, not Manat, nothing of this sort. But he charged Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His charge was, he has divided the house of Quraysh. A house divided in itself cannot stand. We had this position and we still have that position in the whole of Arabia. But if we are divided, father separated from the son and son separated from the father, and wife separated from the husband and husband separated from the wife, this is what he has done to us. So, but he called upon Allah only. Alam ya'lam bi anna Allah yara. Kalla la illam yantahi la nasfa'an bin asiya. Nay, if he desists not, if he doesn't give up this attitude of his, we shall seize him by the forelock. Nasiyatin kazimatin khatiya. Here is the wrath of Allah in verse. The forelock which is lying and sinful. فَلْيَدُوْ نَادِيَاتْ. Let him call his henchmen, people who keep sitting, you know, in his courtyards, etc. سَنَدْعُوا الزَّبَانِيَا. We shall call the angels of the hell. قَلَّا لَا تُطِعْهُ وَاسْجُدْ وَاخْتَرِبْ. Nay. But O Muhammad, you don't obey him. You go on prostrating before your Lord and trying to get nearer and nearer and nearer and nearer to him. Because the Prophet has said, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُنُ الْعَبْدُ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِ فِي السُّجُودِ. The nearest that a servant can go to his Lord is in the position of sajda. This is ayatul sajda. Suratul Qadr, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. وما أدراك ما ليلة القدر ليلة القدر خير من ألف شهر تنزل الملائكة والروح فيها بإذن ربهم من كل أمر سلام هي حتى مطلع الفجر صدق الله العظيم. Surely we sent it down in the night of decree. And what will make you realize, what is this night of decree? The night when the decrees, divine decrees are issued. Divine commands for the coming year. Actually this night is the budget session, annual budget session of this universe. This is the divine government of this world. And this is the night of budget. What is going to happen in this year? Who will die? Who will be born? And all these commands then are handed over to the angels. These are the farameen. Now go and implement them. Because we have in Surah Ad-Dukhan, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatin mubarakah, Inna kunna munzirin, Fiha yufraqu kullu amrin hakeem. During this night, all the solid decrees are issued. Yufraqo, issued. Amra min indina. As a command from us. Inna kunna mursaleen. Verily, we have been the senders of all these commands. So this is the night. And Quran was also sent down in this night. And they had two meanings of this. That the whole of Quran from Lahi Mahfuz, from the Kitab Maknoon, from the Ummul Kitab, that was sent down to the nearest heaven, Samaat Dunya. From there, Jibreel alayhi salatu wassalam, bit by bit, portion by portion, he brought it to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the second meaning is that the first wahi that we have just read was revealed during that Laylatul Qadr. This Laylatul Qadr is in the last 10 days of the month of Ramadan. Laylatul Qadr khairu min alfi shahr. This is better than 1,000 months. What does it mean? If you are vigilant in this light and praying, and an actual and real connection is established between you and your Lord, the reward that you get, that will be more than the reward of worshipping Allah for 1,000 months, minus these nights. Otherwise in 1,000 months, so many years will come, and they will include the night of Qadr also. So this is only to give you an idea how sacred, how important. That is why in the hadith from Sahih Bukhari, Man sama ramadana imanam wahtisaban ghufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbi. Whosoever kept fasting during the month of Ramadan with belief, faith, and hoping to get the reward from Allah, all his previous sins will be expunged. Man qama ramadana imanam wahtisaban ghufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbi. وَمَنْ قَامَ لَيْلَةَ الْقَدْرِ إِمَانًا وَاِحْتِسَابًا غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ. So even this, keeping vigilant and standing during the night of Laylatul Qadr, you know, this is also so important that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives the former sins. And here now we find, تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالرُّوحُ فِيهَا بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرِ. In Surah Al-Dukhan, فِيهَا يُفْرَقُ كُلُّ أَمْرٍ حَكِيمٍ أَمْرًا مِّنْ عِنْدَنَا. All the important matters, they are decided and issued as decrees, ordinances from our presence. And here, the angels and the spirit, that is Ruhul Quds, descend therein by the leave of their Lord for every affair. Salaam. It is peace. Hatta matla'il fajr, and it is till the appearance of the dawn. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Al-Bayyinah. Lam yakunil ladhina kafaru min ahli al-kitabi wal mushrikeen munfakkin hatta ta'tiyahum al-bayyinah. The style of this surah very much resembles the style of the Madani surah, but it is Makki. You know, in Suratul Alaq we found the first revelation which came. In Suratul Qadr, we found when it was sent. And now here, why it was sent. The purpose. لَمْ يَكُنِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ. Those who disbelieve from among the people of the book and the associators who have assigned partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مُنْفَكِّينَ. Those who deviated from the right path, could not leave their false beliefs or wrong paths unless there came hatta taatiyahumul bayyana, unless there came to them a clear proof from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They had gone astray, very far off. The mushrikeen, as well as the people of the book, Ahlul Kitab. Now for them, no ordinary person would be of use. Bayyana was required. A very clear proof. Shining, glittering. And what is that clear, shining, glittering proof? Rasulum min Allah yatlu suhufam mutahharatan. A messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Reciting purified writs and pages or leaves. So these two things go to make bayyana. Not only Quran. Before Quran, Rasul. It's a book. It has to be taught. وَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الزِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِينَ. يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Four times. So teacher and the book. رَسُولٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ. A messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yatlu Sofa Mutahharatan, who came reciting the purified leaves or pages, Fiha Kutubun Qayyimah, for in them are the right ordinances, all the laws, do's and don'ts. But the irony of the fate is, وَمَا تَفَرَّقَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْهُمُ الْبَيِّنَةُ. Those who were given the book, they did not deviate from that path, but after clear proof had already come to them. There are differences between Jews and Christians, etc. They were not due to any darkness. They had the light with them. But as we have read four times in Quran, بَغْيَمْ بَيْنَهُمْ. The cause was the urge to dominate. وَمَا أُمِرُوا. Now this ayah is very important to give you the essence of deen. وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ حُنَفَاءَ وَيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُ الزَّكَاةَ وَذَلِكَ الدِّينُ الْقَيِّمَةَ. And they were not commanded except to worship Allah, keeping their obedience exclusively for Him, and be straight and upright, and then establish the salah and give zakah. And this is the right and eternal deen. Now, لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. And then establish salah. First of all, you have to accept Allah as your sovereign, as your Lord, as your master. And you have to accept His obedience, total obedience, keeping your obedience exclusively for Him. Anybody else can be obeyed, but within the limits of His obedience, not outside that. لا طاعة لمخلوق في معصية الخالق. So first of all, you have to fulfill this condition, and then to be able to continue on this path, you have to establish salah and pay zakah. So actually these are the supports for this ibadah. This is not the ibadah. Ibadah is total obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have explained these things many a time during my Friday sermons during this month. But now we don't have any time. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ. Verily those who disbelieved from among the people of the book and the associators, فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمَ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. They will be in the fire of the hell, abiding therein forever. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ شَرُّ الْبَرِيَّةِ. Verily, those are the worst of creatures. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ خَيْرُ الْبَرِيَّةِ. On the contrary, those who believe and do righteous deeds, they are the best of the creatures. Now correlated with أحسن التقويم and أسفل السافلين. The former is أحسن التقويم. The later is, the former is أسفل السافلين. And the later, أشرف المخلوقات. أحسن التقويم. جزاؤهم عند ربهم. Their recompense or reward is with their Lord in the form of gardens of perpetual bliss. جنات عدن تجري من تحتها الأنهار. Underneath which rivers will be flowing, خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا abada, and they will remain and abide there forever, forever. رضي الله عنه ورضو عنه. Allah will be well pleased with them and they will be pleased with Allah. ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ خَشِيَ رَبَّهُ. This is for those who fear is not their Lord. Now we have a group of four surahs. The warning surahs. The common, you know, subject is warning of the Day of Judgment. Most impressive. And this surah, you know, Surah Al-Zilzal, the Prophet has said it is equal to 1,000 ayat. That is nearly 1/6 of the Quran. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. إِذَا زُلْزِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ زِلْزَالَهَا. When the earth will be shaken with its utmost shaking, وَأَخْرَجَتِ الْأَرْضُ أَسْقَالَهَا, and the earth will cast forth its burdens, throw out whatever it will have within it, فَقَالَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا لَهَا And then man would say, what's the matter with it? What happened to this earth? يَوْمَ اِذِن تُحَدِّسُ أَخْبَارَهَا To add to their surprise, on that day, this earth will relate its tidings, its news, its records, بِأَنَّ رَبَّكَ أَوْحَى لَهَا Because your Lord shall have commanded it to do that. يَوْمَئِذٍ يَصْدُرُ النَّاسُ أَشْتَاتًا On that day, people will be divided. لَيُرَوْا أَعْمَالَهُمْ So that they are shown their deeds. أَشْتَاتًا This is the same word which we have read in Surah Al-Layl. إِنَّ سَعْيَكُمْ لَشَتَّى The result of your endeavors is going to be different. In the same way here. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ So whosoever will have done even a particle's weight of good, he shall see it. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ And whosoever would have done even a particle weight of bad deeds, he will see it. Everything will be before us. Al-Adiyat, and this is the last and the final and the fifth surah of this style. وَالصَّافَّاتِ صَفًّا وَالزَّارِيَاتِ ذَرْوًا وَالْمُرْسَلَاتِ عُرْفًا وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقًا And this, وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ذَرْوًا And this is, there is the consensus that these ayat denote, this only one oath. Ayat are five, but the oath is one. And it relates to the horses. The Arabs used these horses for their internal warfare, especially when they had to go and attack some tribe during the night or the small hours of the morning and plundering and looting and then running back. So they needed swift, you know, some camel who can move them. So what these horses were doing for them? They had no enmity with anybody. But only due to the command of their masters, they were taking all these hardships on them. Even when there was fighting, some arrow could have come and pierced the neck of the horse, and the horse is dead. For whom he is fighting? It's none of his business, it's none of his war. But he is faithful, faithful to his master. The master only looks after him, feeds the horse, looks after him. Only that much. Now the man should look. Is he also faithful to his Lord? Who created him? Who is giving him every need, fulfilling all the need? But are we faithful? No. So this is a reference. وَالْعَادِيَاتِ ضَبْحًا By the charging horses, steeds, who run, snorting and panting for breath. فَالْمُورِيَاتِ قَدْحًا Then they strike sparks of fire with their hooves. And they run, you know, the iron attached to their hooves. And it glides with the pebbles and stones, the spark. فَالْمُغِيرَاتِ سُبْحًا And then there is raid. فَالْمُغِيرَاتِ سُبْحًا Raiding at the dawn. فَالْمُغِيرَاتِ سُبْحًا فَأَصَرْنَ بِهِ نَقَعًا And when they run, they raise a cloud of dust. Now this is the picture of the horses. فَأَصَرْنَ بِهِ نَقَعًا فَوَسَطْنَ بِهِ جَمْعًا And then they penetrate into the thickest part of the host of the enemy, taking the worst risk. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لِرَبِّهِ لَكَنُودُ Look to this horse and look to yourself. Verily, man is ungrateful to his Lord. وَإِنَّهُ عَلَىٰ ذَلِكَ لَشَهِيدُ And he himself is a witness to it. بَلِ الْإِنسَانُ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِهِ بَصِيرًا Only if he sees down, peeps down his heart. وَإِنَّهُ لِحُبِّ الْخَيْرِ لَشَدِيدٌ And he is vehemently in love for the wealth of this world. أَفَلَا يَعْلَمُ إِذَا بُعْثِرَ مَا فِي الْقُبُورِ Does he not know? When the graves will be overturned and excavated out, whatever will be in them. وَحُسِّلَ مَا فِي الصُّدُورِ And that which is in the hearts will be brought out and made manifest. إِنَّ رَبَّهُمْ بِهِمْ يَوْمَ إِذٍ لَخَبِيرٍ Verily your Lord on that day is well aware of them. This is a big threat. Allah knows everything that you did. So we should say, Allahumma hasibna hisaban yaseera. O Allah from us, you take the reckoning with ease. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Azim wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa zikri al-hakim.
Allahu akbar
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having four levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us. or call our toll-free number, 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together, we can make a difference.